So now I am delighted to introduce the first of our two guest speakers. We have a dialogue coming up, and I'll start with Mary Powell. It's my pleasure to introduce Mary, the CEO and president of Green Mountain Power, an investor-owned utility in Vermont. Mary's nationally recognized as an energy visionary, positioning Green Mountain Power, can I just say GMP, even though I'm for acronym busting, but now that we've said it once, everyone has to be quick learners. As a leading energy transformation company, Mary started by restructuring GMP, implementing a cultural transformation under your motto, fast, fun, and effective. I like that. Under Mary's leadership, GMP became the first utility in the world to become a certified B Corporation, showing a commitment to use energy as a force for good. And part of the transformation that I hope we're going to hear about today is about customer-facing innovations, like being the first utility anywhere to offer customers the Tesla Powerwall battery. So let's welcome Mary with a good, strong Midwestern welcome, and come on up, and then we'll bring Chris in a few minutes to have a dialogue.
Thank you. Okay, sip of water first. It is a pleasure to be here. Thank you for that warm welcome. Well, the first thing I have to say is, hi, Imre. Good to see you. So the first thing I have to say is, hi, Imre. It's nice to see you. And actually, that ties in with my first comment, which is, for us at Green Mountain Power, the debate about storage is over. I mean, we don't spend our time debating the economics of storage. We are customer obsessed, we are focused on the future, and we have leaned in hard to storage. And in fact, our very first project was almost 6 years ago. We worked with Imre on it, and it has been a phenomenal project for Vermont, where we built landfill solar, we paired it with storage, we created a microgrid, and it has surpassed any of the penciling that was done on it over 6 years ago. So anyway, with that, it is just wonderful to be here. It's great to be here and talk about a topic that obviously is very important to me, very important to all of you, or we wouldn't be here, which really is energy transformation. I feel like as a part of my bio, because it really informs how I think about things, I need to just mention a couple of things. One is, I'm not an engineer and I'm not a lawyer. I was actually raised as an artist. and I actually didn't grow up in this industry. I actually have started a number of businesses, one that my husband still owns and operates for us. I've worked in a number of different industries, and I am absolutely, without a shadow of a doubt, customer obsessed. I am obsessed with our customers. And it's funny, because I haven't heard so far a lot of chatter about customers. And that is what drives everything about what we're doing. Everything that we're doing is about delivering on our love of our customers. I also talk a lot about love, because I think it's really important as the planet continues to heat up and our customers are demanding transformation. Our customers want energy independence. Our customers want a cleaner environment and a cost-effective environment. So that is what informs our passion, our drive at the company around what we do and what we deliver on their behalf. Starting there, Green Mountain Power is a company. If you remember nothing else about us, and we'll show a little short video that'll catch everything that I miss as I talk, but if you remember nothing else about us, remember that we truly, really are obsessed with our customers. And in Vermont, when you're obsessed with your customers, what that means is the vast majority of them have been telling us for years that they want to move very fast towards clean, renewable, local energy options. That's what they've told us. And in fact, our energy vision started as a kind of joking, right? Because we got all this customer data over a decade ago, and customers were saying they wanted solar. Customers were saying they wanted local, renewable energy. And customers were saying they wanted it to be really low cost. And so we started about 10 years ago kind of giggling, like, oh, isn't that funny? They want it green and they want it free. So, and then we actually said, we called ourselves up short on that, and we said, no, that actually is what they want. They want us, damn it, to figure out how to deliver them an energy future that is cleaner, that is greener, and that is incredibly cost effective. And that is the journey that we've been embarked on for well over a decade. And it started in, I would say, a rather traditional way. Our portfolio now, when it started, our portfolio was about 16% renewable. And today it is 60% renewable and 90% carbon free. But we've got a long way to go. And it started in a way of being focused on, I would say, more traditional utility solutions. So, how can we build cost-effective wind energy for our customers? How can we build cost-effective solar? How can we incent solar? And we did that actually back in 2007, much to probably the dismay of some of my utility peers. We actually kind of created net metering in Vermont. We actually did some math. We said our customers want to move this way, and we actually came up with an incentive we proposed to our Public Utility Commission to actually provide an adder to customers that went with residential solar. And so a lot of how I think about things is informed not just by my customer-obsessed role at Green Mountain Power, but also the fact that, I'm honored to serve on the board of the Rocky Mountain Institute. I'm honored to serve on the board of a rather small solar company, actually, outside of Washington, D.C. And one of the things that is so, so clear to us, and this is a really good lead into kind of how we're thinking about things now and how we look at our starting point on our energy vision, even though it got us pretty far, as really pretty rudimentary as compared to the type of work we're into now. And those, what I would say is all of these life experiences have conspired to really convince me of what seemed obvious to me when I joined this industry many years ago. What do you think that is? When I joined this industry many years ago, the thing that really struck me is that we're still peddling a 130-plus-year-old model. So having come from other industries and seeing rapid transformation in other industries, the most pressing thing that struck me, and again, it ties to some of the learning I've done with some of those other roles I've had, was, oh my gosh, like, why are we still using the exact same, new and improved, albeit in some cases, but really the exact same technologies that we used when we first started building Grandma's Grid? So that really struck me. The other thing that really struck me, and this is really being driven home to all of us, I think, this week and last week watching all of the tragedies unfold with the hurricanes. But the other thing that really struck me is at Green Mountain Power, because we're customer-obsessed, we do what all the great customer-obsessed utilities do, we invest more in the grid. We invest more in the grid to make it more resilient and reliable. And guess what? All it takes, if you're a customer-obsessed leader in a utility that actually spends time out in the field during storms, guess what? All it takes is a couple storms to see that all of that investment basically becomes, in this business, twigs and twine when Mother Nature rolls in. And in fact, I started in this business right after the great ice storm of 1998, which took down even Hydro-Quebec's major transmission lines. All right? So we have Grandma's Grid that hasn't changed a lot. We have climatic events that all of the, new and improved tree wire and this and that and the other thing really can't stand up to the force of nature. And at the same time, back to sort of some of those other roles, we have one of the most radical transformations moving away from Grandma's Grid that we've ever seen going on in the United States and around the globe. And in fact, the U.S. is, as we know, kind of behind a number of other countries in the context of this transformation. I mean, one NREL study says that within the next decade, and I think this is actually a study that's maybe a year and a half old, so maybe it's now within the next 8 years, 40% of American homes and businesses will be self-supplying. 40%. Not necessarily completely, not necessarily not wanting the grid at all, but they will be moving radically towards self-supply. Now cut to that solar company that I get the opportunity to work with. They literally have, they're small, and they literally have hundreds and hundreds of megawatts of proposals that they're working on. And guess where they're mostly working on them? The commercial and industrial space. What we're seeing is, we're seeing more and more, and we're seeing this in Vermont, actually. We're a very small state. We have 609,000 people that live in our state. We don't have that many customers. We already have 1,800 commercial and industrial customers that are self-supplying in some way with solar. That is the technology of the day. That is probably going to continue to proliferate. There we go, I got it. So really where that brings us now at Green Mountain Power is, how do we, we're really focused on how do we accelerate what we see as a consumer-led revolution away from the bulk grid system. So how do we not just say, how do we preserve and protect and take care of, right? But how a part of that cultural transformation that we brought about was a culture of yes, a culture of this business is very, very steeped in complexity. That's the other funny thing that really strikes you when you join this from other industries. Largely, I spent a lot of time in finance, a lot of time in different industries. And one of the things that really struck me is, oh my gosh, it's grandma's grid, but boy, do we complexify it. With all due respect, between regulators and politicians and utilities, and most of the complexity is all around how, I know that's a good idea, but no. It's actually, most of the complexity is about no. You gotta slow down, and I watch some of what's going on around us in the country and it scares me. It actually really scares me, because I think if we spent half of that intellectual and emotional energy saying how do we get to yes, if we spent half of that intellectual and emotional energy building bonds of trust and love with each other to say regulators and utilities, just get in a room and frickin' work together. Like stop maligning, stop like just, get in a room, build trust, build love, and figure this out on behalf of customers. So that's the kind of approach we take. That was a huge part of it, was getting to a team that was small, that was nimble, and that could work fast, fun, and effective, and could be a team about getting to yes. And so that's really what we're focused on, is how do we accelerate this consumer-led revolution away from this bulk system that, the other challenge with it, it's going to be around for a long time, so we've got to figure this out in a way that keeps it stable and resilient. But the other challenge we have is while we have that NREL study, and whether or not it's absolutely true or not, who cares, right? Directionally, we're going towards loads that are flat or declining. Directionally. All right? And all the studies on EVs, I'm sorry, they still don't. All they do is sort of flatten that slope downward. That would otherwise be downward. So what we have is that at the same time that we have unprecedented level of spending on the bulk delivery system. Last year, in 2016, the United States of America spent over $10 billion on socialized cost transmission. That's stunning. So when you think about a system that is either having flat or declining loads or revenues, and that the cost is going up, And it's about 40% economically efficient already on a good day. That doesn't bode well for the future if we don't all lean in and try to figure this out. So we're all in 100% on trying to figure out how to accelerate this consumer-led revolution away from a bulk system to one that is home, business, and community-based. So we believe that a home, business, and community-based energy system, and particularly in a rural state like Vermont, and I have to say rural America and urban America have very different challenges. I grew up in Manhattan. I worked the first 10 years of my career in Manhattan. If I were here running a company that was dealing with the five boroughs, my strategies would probably be similar but very different in some ways. So rural America, we really have the opportunity to create a home, business, and community-based energy system. One where we are flipping the model upside down and we're moving towards having the bulk grid system become our backup system instead of our primary system, which will literally save, in our case, Vermonters tens and tens of millions of dollars of grid cost over the next decade if we can successfully pull this off. So yes, with that in mind, that is why we leaned in very strong to storage, you know, many years ago. We're about in the summer about 640 megawatt peaking utility in the summer, about 760 megawatts in the winter. In the summer, we now have about 300 megawatts of solar. We will have, by the end of next year, about 65 megawatt hours of storage. We're building, working with amazing partners like Tesla, we're building models whereby we have programs where you would take a Tesla Powerwall in your home, you would do it through Green Mountain Power, you would pay a small monthly fee for incredible backup and resilience to carry you through what would be customary and even some very unusual length outages in Vermont. And in exchange for that, we get to use that storage in a way that helps drive down the cost for everybody else served by the grid. We're a contrarian in many, many ways. A huge way we're a contrarian is we actually are not advocating to have any of these things that we're doing done in a traditional utility way, which is they create an unregulated sub that does this work so that it can provide value to its investor as a B Corp. We do all of this within the regulated business so that any additional value streams go back to support all of the other customers who may not be wanting to make the transformation as quickly as those that do. So we're trying to deal with terms like cost shift from a perspective of saying it's our job to actually figure that out and make sure that doesn't happen so that we're meeting customers where they are, we're innovating for them, but we're doing all of those innovations in a way that help drive down the cost of grandma's grid. And so that's, you know, we have a team that meets every single week. The team is called the Zero Rates Team. Their job, as you would guess by the title, is to make sure we have no rate increases. And we have a team that is focused very much on innovation. We have a process by which we've engaged pretty much every part of the company, every corner, in this issue of transformation so that ideas for transformation are coming from all over the company. That's the reason that we were also the first utility in the country to offer customers an off-grid solution. So we have a completely absolute off-grid solution now for customers in Vermont. And knock me over with a feather. I thought the best reason to offer it was just to learn about energy as a service, because that's the way we're going, which is to drive down your total carbon profile and the cost and increase the comfort for you. And we literally got dozens and dozens of customers that are actually interested in that option. So we're really focused on how do we accelerate this transformation. And with that, I think I'll just flip to a short video that hopefully will summarize all the things that I missed, and then I'll sit down and I guess we'll get a chance to talk more about transformation. So with that, flip to the video.
Started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone. And the sun went down as I crossed the hill. And the town lit up. Still, I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing. Well, the good old days may not return, and the rocks might melt. And the seed may burn. But I ain't got wings. Coming down is a hard say life will beat you down and break your heart, steal your crown. So I've started out for God knows where. I guess I'll know when I get there. I'm learning to fly around the clouds. But what goes up must come down.
Okay, we have three working microphones. Thank you. That was fabulous and just very inspiring. And I'm excited to hear what everyone wants to ask, the questions that are coming. But first, I'd like to introduce our Minnesota utility leader, Chris Clark, and then we'll have a dialogue. And I'm really delighted to introduce Chris. And I have to start by saying that I'm proud that my utility, Xcel Energy, is the number one wind utility in the country, and that's a great thing, and has been for many years. And I also just jotted down that Xcel is continuing to pursue a clean energy path that would actually meet the Clean Power Plan requirements and the Paris Agreement, and of course our own state Next Generation Energy Act, and we appreciate that as well. We appreciate your leadership. Chris is the president of Xcel Energy for Minnesota, North Dakota, and South Dakota. He's responsible for Xcel's strategic plan and financial results, as well as the customer's company, community, regulatory, legislative, and governmental relationships in those three states. And Chris has a law degree, just like I do. But yours is from Drake Law School, started in Xcel about 20 years ago or so in energy regulatory experience, and he's a bona fide Midwesterner, having grown up in Iowa. And so we've asked Chris to give an informal presentation today because we want to have an informal dialogue. And so with that, let me turn it over to you and let you give us some background.
Okay. Well, thank you. Mary, I got to say, what a great presentation, what a great video. Really cool to see what you're doing at your utility and what a leader you are. So really enjoyed that. And I love a video that ends with the picture of a cow. That's just cool. That just nothing else. So I warned Mary earlier that somebody sitting next to me referred to us as rock stars earlier. So we're going to see if we can get a rock star or two reference in here. But before we did, just in case there was anyone in the audience, I see a lot of familiar faces, but in case anyone wasn't familiar with Xcel, I thought I'd just walk through a couple of slides to give you an overview of who we are and where we are. So if we could just advance to the next slide, and I don't have very many slides because I really want to get to the discussion, maybe I'll do it. There we go, okay. So we're in eight states. This just gives a little geography. We have a diverse set of states from an energy portfolio mix and also from a political mix, which keeps it interesting. And then the next slide. I just wanted to show this. We've talked a lot about, you know, the potential for battery storage post-hurricanes. On Sunday, we sent crews from Minnesota, from Texas, and from Colorado to Florida, and we're on standby to see what kind of help they need in Houston as well as they sort of dig out from the flooding there, which is a whole different set of issues than what Florida's going through. So it's fun to be part of the community. It's also fun to be part of an industry that pulls together when people need us for restoring what they realize is an essential service pretty quickly once it's gone. And then next slide. This is just where we are in our progression of making progress on the carbon reductions on our Minnesota system. So you can see that by 2021, two-thirds of our energy will be carbon-free, a good mix of renewables and nuclear. The coal at 27% actually drops as we take out the two coal units we've talked about taking out in 23 and 26, and we're hard at work on not only how we get that down to 15% by 30, but what are all the opportunities and what are the new technologies going to allow us to do to go even faster and just move that coal out of the picture completely. Comes with a hitch of what you want to do with that nuclear, but we'll have that fun discussion at a different conference. And then the final slide here. Just wanted to show you pictures of batteries. You know, we do have some pilots on our system we're proud of. And with that, I look forward to a great discussion with Mary and questions from you on.
Great. All right. Thank you. That was very succinct. So we have until, I'm not used to wearing a wristwatch, so I'll try to read this correctly. We have about 20 minutes almost, so this is great. We should have plenty of time for questions. I have a few, and then hopefully you all have a few, so hold up those cards. So let's start by just talking about how much we have in common, Vermont and Minnesota, both cold weather northern states, both a lot of rural and agricultural, I don't know about it, well, you have cows and forests. So yeah, we don't have mountains so much, but and both vertically integrated utility states. And so, you know, what do we have in common and what can we learn from each other? Any thoughts about that? Who wants to start?
I will on that one. Yes, we have a lot in common. And I did quite a drive to get here yesterday, and I thought, oh my gosh, it is so similar to Vermont. So we do geographically, we do in the terms of our climate. So we certainly can learn a lot from each other in terms of the technologies and understanding what works. But the other thing where I really jumped up and said, oh yeah, with the microphone, was because I really believe that the states that did not deregulate are at such a strategic advantage if they seize it to innovate on behalf of customers in a way that we have complexified in the deregulated states. So again, the model that we're using is, again, how do we leverage having that fully integrated monopoly to a degree right that we have to be part of transformation in a way that works for all of the customers. I mean, I might add that there is no such thing as a fully regulated state anymore in the world of distributed technologies, because in many ways, Vermont did deregulate electricity supply 10 years ago when we allowed customers to go solar, right, for their primary energy delivery. But that said, I think that's one of the things we really share, is how can we really be in the lead of innovation, you know, and really leverage that fully integrated utility model.
Any thoughts?
Well, I really agree with Mary on that point, that I think that we have a great advantage in our states with the regulatory model that we work with. I have a tremendous opportunity in front of us. And I also agree that this is really becoming completely customer-driven now. It's really interesting having conversations, and I mentioned the political diversity of our states, with people after the election at the federal level and then after the withdrawal from Paris of, well, what does this mean from your system? And in a very careful way, we really want to make sure that we're educating and saying it's really kind of irrelevant to the system, because two things are really driving us fast to the future. One is the economics, and we're seeing tremendous economics with the change in our system. It's a transition, it's a transformation, and it's going fast. And that is fun. So I agree with you completely. Tremendously fun time to be in the industry. We do trip over ourselves sometimes in making it complex, but hey, it is really a fun time in the industry. And the second thing is, customers are speaking louder about what they want. And it's interesting because, you know, at first it was sort of attributed to, well, those are the California companies, the Googles, the Apples, and that's not all companies. But what we're really seeing is it move completely across the spectrum. The Walmarts, the Targets, are trying to race each other to see what they can do in this transformation. And beyond that, we have communities who are clearly becoming much more active in telling us what they want. But even beyond that, you can completely get out of that, what you could describe to political, or these industries have the luxury of being more retail facing. Manufacturing sector is starting to see this coming, and I think this is going to be the most dramatic change. We have manufacturers of things that would sound pretty much like a commodity, pipe and other types of things, that are asking us, how can you help us get decarbonized faster? Because we're listed on the European Stock Exchange, because our customers are demanding it, or because who we supply to are demanding it. GM now has a goal, and I think this is going to move aggressively through supply chains, and I think that we're going to see this customer focus really just keep accelerating, and it's going to make it challenging, but I like a challenge, so it should be a lot of fun.
Great. Well, so first I have to ask, did you drive here from Vermont?
No.
Just to be clear, I haven't had a chance to ask you. Okay, you just had a long...
No, I just had business down in Madison, so I actually drove through Wisconsin, but yeah.
Great, okay. Well, that's, you know, good Midwest sightseeing. Excellent. So this is really interesting because I think our regulators, I think Commissioner Thomas probably is the one who talked especially about, well, the regulatory framework doesn't necessarily work the best to encourage innovation. I think that was what I heard from him, and you're saying, both of you are saying that that's kind of a luxury that we have, that that's a system in place that can enable this grid modernization and transformation that we're talking about. So that's really interesting. So let me ask you, both of you, separately as well, how have you worked with your regulators to find support for some of these innovative new products, new customer services? You know, what barriers do you face with the regulatory framework in trying to advance innovation and new grid technology? Are regulators supportive of these customer-facing opportunities when not all customers necessarily want the same thing and some don't want to pay more than others? How does that work out? So I guess it's your turn.
Okay, well, that was a lot. I'm like, okay, which part? So yes, I do believe actually that it's incredible opportunity. And I think I'm a firm believer in the line that culture eats strategy. It does. Culture eats strategy for breakfast, I think is the line somebody said. And I like to say it eats strategy for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And so, you know, we could not be doing what we're doing today if we didn't focus on the culture of our organization and always on the regulatory compact. And I think one of the things, that was helpful to us is when I first came, and you know, as I said, I worked in many different spaces, and one of them was actually in government service. So I actually worked for the state of Vermont for a number of years, and we very quickly, when I came to the organization, I tried to focus the team on, we have the same interest as the regulators. Like, we have the same interest. Like, everybody's just got to, like, drop whatever rock they're carrying and just, like, and honestly, that maybe park the lawyers for a few minutes and, like, just to focus on, we're here for the same freaking reason, which is to serve in our case, the residents of the state of Vermont, you know, which are our customers. We serve 78% of them. And, you know, and so it helped, I think, that I came from state service, from a stint in it, you know, and I could say to the folks at Green Mountain, like, they're smart people too. So the other thing is, the other opportunity is, get the smart people together to figure out how to get to yes instead of how to tear down what the other one's doing. And I think culturally that is the biggest challenge I see facing us from a regulatory perspective. And I don't say this, I think utilities are just as responsible for it as regulators, but you know, they're really, in order to leverage it, like you can't just, I can't just say the fully integrated model is a great opportunity without talking about the culture. Because if you can't figure out a path to change the cultural dynamic between the regulator and the company that's serving the customers, then it becomes very hard. Then it becomes very hard. But I, you know, yeah, so I really believe that at the end of the day, if you're both really focused on customers, where you can leverage the model is to say, how do we want our utility to play in this to help accelerate the transformation? There's nothing we're doing that is to the exclusion of private developers being in those same spaces. In fact, we've, as part of being a B Corp, we've accelerated, we've attracted business to Vermont, we've attracted innovators to Vermont because of the work we're doing. So there doesn't need to be, there's a lot of like old paradigms about utilities, about regulators, and a huge part of it is, I think, a willingness to say we're gonna deal with that cultural transformation head on so that we can actually all get our head in the game about what the best thing is for customers and take some risk and move. Move. Get to yes.
Is that turned on? Sorry, I'm not sure.
We'll check and see.
Wait, I got
one. All right, can you repeat the question? You know, I think when I look at what we're trying to accomplish and I think about how important the regulatory compact is and how we get to success there, I think part of it is finding ways to bring ideas and bring them to the finish line more quickly. And this is something that we're trying to get better at. And to your point of utilities own helping with this, that's something that we recognize that we need to bring ideas and then help the discussion move more rapidly to the finish line. I also think we build on a great foundation of a constructive relationship with our regulators. And I think if you look at the conservation programs and the success that we've had in Minnesota with those programs, it's a tremendous platform that has allowed many to apply, that has accomplished enormous success. And it's a great platform to look at and think about how were we able to achieve that, and what are the things that worked so well there that we can then translate over as we chase new opportunities and ideas. And I think the other thing that we've had great success with our regulators in being able to tell the story and let it be poked and prodded and tested, but then a recognition of, yes, let's grab this opportunity. The recent wind acquisition that we went forward with, I remember before we really started getting good price visibility into what we were gonna see, having a conversation with Bill Grant about whether we should, you know, take a look at doing 200 or 400 megawatts and what would be a little bit too much to take on in this resource plan in this time frame. Well, once we saw how great the prices were, what a great opportunity there was, we end up coming forward with 1,550 megawatts of wind energy and a lot of fun. And the Department of Commerce and the Commission embraced that. And it's been a great story to then be able to go and tell about how we're taking advantage of this and how we're driving to the future. And just around the corner is a lot more wind, a lot more solar, and a lot more need to figure out how storage and other things fit in. So I'll just stop there and say I just think that we build on a great foundation, and I really look forward to moving and challenging ourselves to how we move forward quickly.
Great. So I'm going to ask one question that I picked from the audience because it's similar to my question that I already wrote down, sorry. But I think it's important to ask about how, I mean, you're both investor-owned utilities, so how do you, and for Mary especially, because your model is so innovative and unique, how do you keep your shareholders happy in the work that you're doing? And how can you balance some of these questions about, well, you know, do you believe that utility revenues generally are in that death spiral and you have to worry about how to maintain earnings as a vertically integrated utility?
Yeah, so I feel like the model we've adopted is the model. In the video, you may not know the characters I was standing with when I was holding the little B Corp sign, but I was actually standing with Ben and Jerry of Ben and Jerry's. And they were the ones who were very, very excited to be there and talked about, actually, I think the line was, the first utility in the galaxy to become a benefit corporation. And, you know, what is really funny is actually if you look at the benefit corporation community of corporations, you know, Patagonia, Seventh Generation, there are good companies that are producing good results. The reality is it's just, I think, a completely different orientation that has always made sense to me in my career and has helped grow a couple successful businesses that I've started, which is, to me, feels like common sense. Actually, if you focus on your customer first, your investor, whether it's yourself or somebody else or whoever, will do fine. They'll do fine. That the most important thing, especially in this business, I mean, that's really what we're paid to do, is focus on customers. So I think in our case, you know, I would say we're lucky that we have an investor that is supportive. I would say it's probably no surprise that we have a Canadian investor. I often say to our regulators, I hope you appreciate that you actually have like a socialist investor, because they really do support the notion of caring about communities, caring about customers. And, you know, we've used terms in our boardroom. I used the term years ago, which is we don't deal with greed. Like, we don't expect our investor to get any more than they deserve. And our obsession is our customers. And so with that focus, you know, we've done fine. And yes, we do believe in the death spiral. I don't call it, I mean, yes, it is a death spiral. If you're into preserve, protect, and defend, and you're running a traditional utility, like my first quote, if you sit on the lid of progress, expect to be blown to bits. I mean, so we just look at it as progress. Actually, I just look at it as it's about time. It's freaking way overdue that we move away from this big, bulk, economically inefficient system. But yes, if all you're looking at is a traditional viewpoint, it is a death spiral. But we look at it as an opportunity to create transformation for our customers. And so back to your great point about commercial customers, too, that is some of the amazing work we're already engaged with customers on is dramatically reducing their greenhouse gas emissions. And some of it's smart electrification. A lot of it, though, is using different distributed generation resources. So we're trying to create new value streams back for that new added value that we bring to customers. So it is an exciting time.
I think it's great that we talk about investors, because we are investor-owned utilities, and we do spend time thinking about what's our value proposition that we're offering. And I have to tell you that I think our investors right now really appreciate two things that we're bringing to the table. One is a vision of how we're going to lead to the future, and we call that Steel for Fuel with our investors, and we're able to explain to them that adding this wind to our system is actually going to help us make the transformation of our system that our customers are asking us to make, that we think the overall public wants us to make. They may debate the time frame, but we think they want it. You go interview Generation Z, and I think the answer is clear. So we are charging forward with that and doing it in a way that saves customers money and provides investor value. They love the story, I think, and we're going to keep working to show that we're delivering that value to them. I think the second thing that they look for and we're able to deliver is showing that we can do this and do it in a way where we maintain that certainty or that regulatory construct that they look for to know that you're not just gambling, you're moving in a direction that makes sense with the policies of your states. And when you have different states, that becomes more challenging. We spend a lot of time trying to navigate. We spend a lot of time telling the story of the value of what we're doing across our communities and our jurisdictions. You know, I think the story of becoming a B Corp is fascinating, and it's part of the reason I show the picture of our employees going to do the hurricane relief. We had more employees volunteer than we could send, because in case we get a storm here, we need to make sure we can keep the lights on here. But it really is the culture. We had a day of service last week, and we had employees volunteer go around the community. People love to do that, and then I get asked questions. One of the nonprofits I was at, the leader said, "Oh, my son just graduated with a degree in sustainability. Is that something you guys are into?" Well, yeah, I'm glad you asked. We'll spend a little bit of time on that. You should go look at our sustainability report, and let's get your son in and do an informational interview. So a lot of fun. Okay, and the death spiral. I gotta have some fun with this. You called us rock stars earlier. I'm not sure. I didn't wear my black T-shirt and jeans. I thought about it, to signal that we're embracing the future. But REM song, what is it? Lawyers can be cool. The end of the world as we know it, and I feel fine. Whenever I get asked about the death spiral, or we sit around and think, oh my gosh, sales are going down. Well, yes, they are. That's our conservation programs, among other things. So I think for some, the death spiral is real. I think the dramatic change is coming to our industry, and I feel fine because it's a challenge that we're embracing, and we're going to lead the way. And one last point on investors. So I mentioned earlier that a lot of people ask us post-election, does this mean you're going to go petition to keep your coal plants open rather than continue to make the change? And I said, no, we made the right business decision. We're seeing investor pressure on a lot of utilities who haven't even started talking about how they're going to do it. And that pressure isn't just on the IOUs, it's on the non-IOUs who have to go issue debt to the same folks who are out shopping the debt with people. And those investors are putting pressure on, what's your plan to satisfy the reduction in carbon? What's your plan to diversify your fleet away from a very heavy coal profile or whatever it is they're concerned about? So the pressure is coming in another set of customers in a way that I think are really going to continue to drive the change.
So am I on now? Yeah. I actually have three more questions I want to ask you, and we have 2 minutes. So can we? Well, we'll have to do a lightning round here. I'll tell you the three questions, and then I guess you can, pick and choose if we don't have time. One is, there's a lot of questions about kind of how do the economics work, Mary, especially with what you're talking about. We hear often that, large scale, utility scale solar, for example, is so much more cost effective than customer sited, and how do the customers pay for it? Do they have to pay more? How do they get value out of their power walls? Is that because they just want to be green and independent, or is it because they're saving money? So sort of that whole economics question. Should I say all three of the questions? Maybe that's too confusing. But second one is, what are the cultural differences? This is really, as you talked about culture, eating everything else for breakfast, lunch and dinner, is it, that Vermont is so unique that you have the support for these kinds of things? Or, could Minnesota go as far as Mary's gone in a lot of ways and get people behind it? I think that's a really interesting question. And how much is literally about politics? And then the third question, and this is one I want to ask, is based on what we heard earlier today, where do competitors, where do third parties, where do aggregation, where do innovators play in this new space, and how do we incorporate them into sort of a pathway towards innovation? That's a big, big honking question.
Really? Oh, Lord. Okay, that was a mouthful. So I think the most important thing, and I'll try to do rapid fire. The most important thing, by the way, of that death spiral, and this gets to the questions, is not about us. Actually, the most important thing about that is what happens to customers. Because if revenues just keep dropping and the grid cost just keeps going up, that just means rates just keep going up. And that's untenable. And we've had a number of rate bill decreases. We've had 3 bill decreases in the last 4 years because of our focus on how do we create every single thing we're doing as an opportunity to drive down the grid costs and to add value to customers. So each program has its own economics to it. And there's some, like the Powerwall, where the customer is just choosing, instead of buying a big honking fossil fuel generator, which is what a lot of rural America does, they're choosing to do a Powerwall instead. So they're willing to pay the $15 a month instead of $8,000 out of pocket for a generator the size to run an average Vermont home, so that they have that backup power and that reliability. And we share the value so that we bring other grid values to it. Back to culture, I don't want to mislead anybody in that it's not like we have this situation in Vermont where we're dancing through the woods holding the hands of the regulators, right? In fact, we're going through a round now. Every time you have a change of administration, you have change of regulatory compacts, and we're in a very traditional cycle. And what we try to do is embrace it with love and embrace every single thing with our customer obsession. And so we make sure we have tons and tons of data on how our customers feel, what they want us to be doing, because at the end of the day, the thing that we share with whoever, it doesn't matter if it's an R, if it's a D, if it's an I, we share this with every single governor and every single regulator is we all will do better if we're doing what customers want. So that's why we keep coming back to data-based customer solutions with hopefully revenue paths that are working, and we're working on a 10-year forecast. We look out 10 years, what does the future look like if we lost 40% of traditional revenue? What do we have to do to innovate in ways that Vermonters want us to do to fill that gap?
And even low-income customers.
Absolutely.
Yep.
No, because again, it's about, remember I said we delivered bill decreases, so that's about all customers, which is our economy in Vermont's very fragile. We have 600,000 residents, so it's low income, whether it's low income or CNI customers, low rates are king.
I'll jump in and try to rapid fire the questions as well. I think that on the economics are critical to us being able to make the transformation that we are. And we have a great wind resource in our backyard. We across our footprint have a great solar resource and even a much better solar resource here in the upper Midwest than people think. We're excited about making the transition and showing that we're able to do it affordably for our customers. Economies of scale work in our backyard, so we're trying to take advantage of that, but it's not to the exclusion of other types of transformation that are gonna happen. And I think just to underscore it, people love technology. You can see it by all the hoopla around the new iPhone, and we're going to see some of that in our sector. And I think for us, it's figuring out, you know, where are the opportunities to be helpful to that? We're talking about batteries today. I think here in our region, we're going to see more eagerness on the electric vehicle side, maybe before we see the rooftop solar and the power walls, but we did see in the paper last week some power walls being installed. So definitely there are people who are excited and interested. I think overall, as we talk about what the culture is, for us it's that culture of showing we're willing to lead. We're showing that we can put the right framework around it. And when we talk about bringing that to Minnesota and our other states, I think it is finding the mix that works for our states. For us, going to the conservation programs is just such a success. It's a nice platform to look at, and it's one where third parties can play. We have other ways in the Midwest where we've played with third parties as well. Certainly, big data is coming to our industry too. And it's fun talking to the Amazons and the Googles because they've figured out we run a complex machine. They want to let us run the machine, but they'll crunch the data for us. And I think there's exciting frontiers coming there as well. So I think we're just at the beginning of seeing what third parties can do for us.
I think we're out of time. So let's thank this wonderful panel.
All right, everyone. Thanks again. Thanks so much, Chris and Mary. That was really awesome. You guys are rock stars for all of us energy nerds. So my name is Barb Jacobs. I work for the Institute on the Environment, the Energy Transition Lab with Ellen. And one of the things INE loves to do is partner with people within the community. And one of our new programs that's going to be debuting soon is a partnership with the Institute on the Environment and the Carlson School of Management. It's an executive education class for people like you. And we're lucky to have Chris Clark as one of our partners in that program. He's going to be helping to teach the class. Some of you have information in your packets pertaining to this. For those that don't, you can find information about this on the Carlson School of Management website. And then, of course, lunch. We're going to be taking a break until 1 o'clock. There's boxed lunches. You are welcome to eat them anywhere you want. You can come back in here. You can go hang out anywhere in the union here. You can go outside. Just make sure to be back here at 1 o'clock. Thank you very much.